أنعمك وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. أما بعد، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وما ينطق عن الهوى إن هو إلا وحي يوحى. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد المبارك وسلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد المبارك وسلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد المبارك وسلم. Alhamdulillah. So last time we started the session on Riyadu Salihin, and what I did last time was went over the basic definitions of hadith, and I did I talk about Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi last time? I did. So Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi, just to again highlight that he only lived for 46 years of age, and the barakah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in his life was amazing. And the reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose him to take so much work of hadith from him was because of his zuhud, because of his taqwa. And just to highlight that, you know, he was a muhaddith, but in fact he followed the school of Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayh. So that's like a sort of like, I don't need to give a proof, but this is a proof by itself that hadith is a different science and fiqh is a different science. So people cannot just derive fiqh, you know, if they know hadith or if they know Quran. There are mufassireen who are following the school, a different school in their fiqh of a different imam, and he's a muhaddith, and such a big muhaddith, and he knew all of them, mashallah, you know, he was a master of hadith, Imam Nawawi rahmatullah alayhi, and fiqh he was following the school of Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi. So the first hadith that he has put in his book is the hadith of intention. And it is very interesting to note that almost all the muhaddiseen who have written the books of hadith, they have always mentioned the hadith of intention as to start their books. Imam Bukhari rahmatullah alayh in his Sahih, this is the same hadith that he also put in his book, and other muhaddiseen as well. So this is a hadith that is narrated by Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. It says, an Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, innama al-a'malu bin-niyyati. وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ لِدُنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا أَوْ امْرَأَةٍ يَنْكِحُهَا فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِ مُتَّفِقٌ عَلَى صِحَّتِهِ رواه إمام المحدثين أبو عبد الله محمد ابن إسماعيل بن إبراهيم ابن المغيرة بن زبط الجعفي البخاري وأبو الحسين مسلم ابن حجاج ابن مسلم القشيري النيسابوري رضي الله عنهما في صحيحهما الذين هما أصح الكتاب المصنفة. So this hadith is muttafaqun alayhi. And if you remember, Imam Nawawi rahmatullah alayhi, he also mentioned in the khutbah of his book, he said that whenever I say that it's muttafaqun alayhi, that would mean that it is mentioned in the sahihain, in the two sahihs of Imam Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi and Imam Muslim rahmatullah alayhi. And this hadith, this particular hadith, is narrated by Amir al-Mu'mineen, Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. And he says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ, that indeed actions are with intentions. وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى, and indeed every person will get what he has intended. فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, and whoever's migration is for Allah and His Messenger, فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, then indeed his hijrah, his migration is for Allah and His Messenger. وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ لِدُنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا, and whoever's migration is for worldly things, to achieve that, to get that, أَوْ إِمْرَأَةٍ يَنْكِهُهَا, or for a woman to marry her, فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِ, then his migration is for what he has migrated for. It's a beautiful hadith. Question number one. Why do the muhaddiseen bring this hadith at the start of their books? The reason is twofold. Reason number one is that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that every action is based on intentions. So the muhaddiseen, whoever, when they start writing their book, they make sure that their intention is right. And number two, they are reminding me and you that now that we are reading these beautiful books of ahadith, these beautiful gems, we need to also make sure that our intentions are right. Then we need to make sure that there is no other reason to study this book, to teach this book, except that we want to gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by doing that. So that is the reason that the muhaddiseen have put this book, put this hadith at the beginning of their books. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying that إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ, that indeed actions are with intentions. The mufassireen of this hadith, or our fuqaha, have differed on the opinion of the interpretation of this hadith, this portion of the hadith. There is one opinion where the fuqaha have said that indeed actions are only valid with intentions. That means that if the intention is not there, the action will not even be valid. And the second opinion is that actions are rewarded with intentions. That if there will be no intention, the action will be valid, but the reward of that action will not be there. Or, based on the intention, the reward will be accordingly. And this difference, this opinion, is for those actions which are not the goal of Sharia, which are not the maqsood of Sharia. For example, the prayer is a goal of Sharia, it's a maqsood. Fasting is a goal of Sharia, it's maqsood. Hajj is a goal of Sharia, it's maqsood. Zakat is the goal of Sharia, it's maqsood. So for those actions in which are not the goal of Sharia, this is where the difference of opinion lies. Otherwise, everybody agrees that the actions are only valid with intention. What do I mean by that? For example, wudu, tahara. It is not a goal in Sharia. Tahara is needed to pray. Tahara is needed to touch the Quran. Tahara is needed to do tawaf of the Kaaba. So, it is a prerequisite. It's not a goal by itself. It's a prerequisite to do certain, to achieve certain goals of Sharia. So the fuqaha have differed that if there are such actions which are not the goal of Sharia, then will the action be valid with intention, without intention or not? So one action, one interpretation is, and that Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi his interpretation, he says that even those actions which are not the goal of Sharia, that will not be valid without intention. Or in other words, they will only be valid with intention. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ And Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi, he says that it means for those actions which are not the goal of Sharia, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ means that the actions will be rewarded according to the intention. So that means that somebody makes wudu according to his opinion, his fiqh, his rulings, that somebody makes an intent, makes a wudu and he does not have the intention of making wudu, his wudu will still be valid, but he will not get the reward of wudu. That's what he means. So for example, the farad of the wudu of four, as Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, وَإِذَا قُمْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ فَاغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ وَامْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ إِلَى الْكَعْبَيْنِ These are the four farad of wudu. Washing of the hands, so washing of the face, hands until the elbows, wiping of the head, washing of the feet. So Imam Hanifa Abdullah says that if somebody, say, dives into a clean swimming pool, a pure swimming pool, and all of these farad are washed, that even if they did not have an intention of washing these body parts, his wudu will still be valid. All of them will not get the reward. So according to him, actions are rewarded according to intentions. Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi says that actions are not even valid without intentions. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ And then Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained this hadith. And he says, وَإِنَّمَا لِإِمْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى And every person will get whatever he intends. So that means you make an intention and you will get the reward of that accordingly. Different intentions, different rewards. And then he further explained, فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ Before I go into that, there is أسباب الورود for this, with this hadith. What is أسباب الورود? There is a reason, or أسباب النزول, it also comes. It's normally used for the verses of the Quran, but it's also used for the hadith as well. Then why was this hadith said? Why did Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say this particular hadith? So there was a أسباب الورود, and that was that there was a Sahabi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, his name was Muhajir Qais. Nobody knows his name. Everybody knows him by Muhajir Qais, a person who migrated for a woman called Qais radiallahu ta'ala anha. Qais was a Sahabiya, and this Sahabi radiallahu anhu, he wanted to get married to her. So this Sahabiya, she put a condition. She said that if you want to get married to me, I'm migrating to Madinah Munawwara, you will have to come, you will also have to migrate. And he agreed, and he migrated to Madinah Munawwara to get married to Qais radiallahu ta'ala anha. So he was known as Muhajir Qais, a Sahabi who migrated for Qais radiallahu anha. And you know, outwardly is not a very good thing to do, right? And our mashayikh have said one beautiful thing. They said that this is a perfect example of hiding the faults of other people. Of having that attribute of being satar, of hiding faults. Nobody, none of the Sahabi, they mentioned his name, who he was. Everybody knew who he was. Nobody mentioned who he was. And everybody called him the name of Muhajir Qais, so that people will not even know, the people who will hear about this in later generation, me and you, they will not even know who that Sahabi was. SubhanAllah. He was known as Muhajir Qais. And because he migrated for the sake of getting married to a Sahabi radiallahu ta'ala anha, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he got to know about this, he said this, that إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ Every action is based on intentions. وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى. And every person will get whatever he has intended. And then Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. If somebody intends to migrate for the sake of Allah and His Messenger, hijrah, migration from one place to another place is a beautiful act, is a very rewarding act, is a very praiseworthy act. If it is done for the sake of Allah and His Messenger, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that if somebody migrates for Allah and His Messenger, then his reward is accordingly. He will have the reward of migrating for the sake of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But for man karat hijratuhu, or man karat hijratuhu ila dunya yusibuha, but if somebody migrates for to seek any worldly gains, or for to get married to a woman, أو إمرأةٍ يتزوجها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه, then his migration is for whatever he migrated for. Hijrah is normally done or should be done if there is a place where the people of that place, they do not allow you to practice your religion. And if they do not allow you to practice your religion, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants that we leave that place and go to a place where they are allowed to practice their deen. We are born to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our job is to live a life of Allah. So if there is a place where there are restrictions that people do not allow to live a life of Allah, Allah Ta'ala wants from all of us that we leave that place and go to a place where we can. Because this is the goal, purpose of our life, no? And the goal. This is hijrah. And this is a very rewarding, praiseworthy act in the sight of Allah. Because not an easy thing. Imagine, you are living in a place, you are born in a place, you are living in a family, you have parents, you have brothers, you have sisters, you have relatives, you have friends, you have family, you have kids, right? And suddenly you have houses, you have businesses, and just for the sake of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you leave everything behind and you go to another place. It's a very, very hard thing to do. It's a very hard thing to do. Even Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was leaving Makkah Mukarramah, when he was forced to leave Makkah Mukarramah, he had tears in his eyes. He was extremely sad. And he looked at the Kaaba and he said, "Oh Kaaba, you are very beloved to me. I do not want to leave you. But what can I do? The people of your city do not let me live in this place." He was extremely sad. It is extremely hard to do that. But if somebody does that for the sake of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then Allah Ta'ala gives them a lot of reward. But when the intention is right. When the intention is right. If somebody migrates for any other sake, for any worldly thing, then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَجْرَ إِلَيْهِ, then he will not get the reward. All his intentions are mixed. Then he will not get the reward, or he'll get the reward accordingly, whatever the dominant intention is. For example, somebody has this bad habit of looking around at non-married women or men, watching movies, for example. It's a sin. Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ. Tell believing men, women, lower your gaze, as a hukam of Allah ordered. Now, somebody, he does not intend that I will leave this sin. But Allah Ta'ala takes away his eyesight. He becomes blind or she becomes blind. Now that he becomes blind or she becomes blind, she says, "Oh no, 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 I will not look at anybody now." He doesn't even have an opportunity to do that. So he will not get the reward of not looking at anybody. So whatever is the intention, they will get the reward accordingly. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying that if somebody's hijrah, migration, is to gain any worldly means, for example, somebody says that, you know what, I'm living at this place, but if I go to that place, you know, my business will really, really drop. You know, there are a lot of opportunities to do business at a certain place. So I'm going to do hijrah. I'm going to migrate from my place to that place. Even though the place that he was living in, the people did not allow him to practice his deen, and the place that he's going to, they allow him to practice his deen, even though that is present. But if the intention is that he's migrating for the worldly things, for worldly gains, for worldly benefits, he will not get the reward of the migration. The question, and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى الدُّنْيَا يُسِيبُهَا أَوْ إِمْرَأَةٍ يَتَزَوَّجُهَا فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِ. But if somebody migrates for to gain worldly means, worldly gains, or to marry a woman, then he will get whatever he is intended for. His migration will be for what he is intended for. Women also come under the worldly things. Right? Marriage is a worldly thing. All this part of our deen as well, but outwardly speaking, to get married is like a worldly thing. Right? So why did Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mention أَوْ إِمْرَأَةٍ يَتَزَوَّجُهَا separately? Our ulama have said that the reason the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said might be one out of these two. Number one, because of the Aswabul Wuru, because of the Aswabul Nuzul, the reasons for revelation. It was about the Sahabiyah and the Sahabi who migrated for that Sahabiyah, for a woman, to get married to her. Maybe that's the reason. Or number two, the biggest fitna of this ummah for men is women. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in one of the hadiths, close meanings, that the biggest fitna of this ummah for men are the women. So to highlight that fitna, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that separately, even though that was included in the dunya. This is a very big fitna, and this is the biggest fitna. It has always been a fitna, but the more we are going into darkness, it is becoming more big fitna. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was the light, source of light. وَدَعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ بِإِذْنِهِ وَسِرَاجًا مُنِيرًا. He was a burning lamp. He was a source of light. And everybody who was around him were in that light. They could see things very easily. And the people who were close to this time could see things very clearly. That is why the Khair al-Qurun, as I mentioned last time, I don't know if I did or not, but Khair al-Qurun are the first three generations, the best of the generations. خير القرون قرني ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم. The best of generation is my generation, then who follows them, then who follows them. They were able to see things very clearly. But after that, people started getting into the darkness. And the more we are going away from the time of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the more we are going into darkness. And the more we go into the darkness, the more fitnas prevail. And that is why, you know, the day of judgment would come, then there will be so many fitnas, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that will fall one after another, just like when you have this one, your tasbih. You know, if it breaks, and the way that, what do you call it? The beads. The way that they fall, the similar way the fitnas will fall. And we can see every day, you read the newspaper every day and you hear a news story. These are signs of the closeness of the Day of Judgment. So the more we go away from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the more we get into the fitna. And it has always been the fitna, but it has become even a greater fitna in this day and age. And honestly speaking, if I would say that the 90% of the, out of all the fitnas, the 90% fitnas are this, I possibly won't be exaggerating. This is the biggest issue of this time. You talk to anybody, be it a man or a woman, be it a boy or a girl, this is their issue. This is their issue. And because of these shaitani weapons, namely the cell phones and this internet, you know, this fitna has prevailed so much, it has expanded so much that I can't even tell you how is it destroying people. You know, my Shaykh, he calls cell phone a hell phone. And it's literally a hell phone. The way that this cell phone is taking people into the fire of hell, I can't even tell you. SMSs, talking to non-mahram boys and girls all night long. It's literally taking people into the hellfire. And internet. You know what is internet? It's www. World Wide Web. It's a shaitani web. Internet is entering into that net of shaitan. This has caused so much destruction again, you know, that we can't explain. Every other person, if not every person, is into this fitna. And they have gotten into this fitna that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is mentioning here. Everybody, be it a boy or be it a girl, this issue is one of the biggest issues. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created that as a test for us, this test in general, a test of the opposite gender. But our job is to stay away from that. Our job is to follow the Sharia. Our job is to make sure that we keep ourselves within the bounds of the deen, within the bounds of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tilka hududullah. Allah ta'ala says, these are the boundaries set by Allah. وَمَنْ يَتَعَدَّ هُدُودَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Whoever crosses the boundaries of Allah, they are oppressors. Allah Ta'ala has given us boundaries. And we have to keep ourselves within those boundaries. And this is a natural attraction when Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala has said that you keep yourself within the boundaries. And there are fitna. There is a hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, النِسَاءُ حَبَائِلُ الشَّيْطَانِ. The women are the entrapments of shaitan. They are the web of shaitan. They are the nets of shaitan. It's not talking bad about women. Absolutely not. What Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, that shaitan will use women to trap men. And it is up to the women. Will they want to be the weapons and the entrapments of shaitan in order to trap men or not? That's why they are supposed to be modest. That's why they're supposed to cover themselves up. That's why hijab. Hijab is not a scarf. Hijab is not to tie a scarf around your head and then wear like skin-tight jeans and, you know, skin-tight tops and, you know, go out in the marketplaces with their makeups on, with eyebrows made and attracting other people. This is not hijab. That's why Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's la'na, his curse is on those people who make up their eyebrows, on those women. That's why Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's curse is on those women who put on perfumes, the spreading perfumes that spreads and attracts people. Why is that? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was rahmatul lil alameen. He was the rahmah. He was the one who was crying all night for this ummah. That how can my ummah be saved? At time of his death, when Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam and Sayyidina Israel alayhi salam, they came and asked permission that, and Allah Ta'ala is calling you. Allah Ta'ala is calling you. And he said, you know, I'm ready to go, but I need to know what will happen to my ummah after my death. And Allah Ta'ala said, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَىٰ. You know, I will make you extremely happy regarding your ummah. I will not leave them alone. Only then Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, اللهم رفيق الأعلى. I choose Allah who is my best friend, who is my highest friend. He was so concerned about his ummah until his death. Why is he sending curse on people? Curses, la'nas. Because these are the things that become the weapon of shaitan. These are the things that distracts people from their deeds. That is why. So women have to be modest. They have to put on, you know, hijab, because that's their honor. They're like diamonds. Lu'lu'il maknun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned about the hood in the Quran, ka'amthali lu'lu'il maknun. They are like hidden pearls. Anything that's beautiful, that's precious, that's always covered up, that's, you know, you always protect it. If you have, for example, a precious thing like a diamond, a solitaire, you don't keep it open, you know, don't leave it open. When you go home, you take it out, put it in a, you know, in a box and store it in a secure place. It's precious. Women are precious. Allah Ta'ala has given them ikram. Allah Ta'ala said that the paradise is under the feet of the mothers. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if somebody has 2 daughters or more, and they take care of these 2 daughters or more, and you know, to get them married, they will be with me in paradise like this. This is the ikram of the women that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is doing. Remember which time? This was a time when people felt so bad having daughters, that every time they will have a daughter, they will bury them alive. Because of the humility. They will feel that humility within themselves, that they have been given daughters. At that time, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is raising the status of women. وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. Allah Ta'ala has said, you know, you deal with your wives in the best manners. Allah Ta'ala's advice to people, to believers. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is taking his last breaths. And he could hardly speak. Everything okay? He's taking his last breaths. And he's saying, As-salah, as-salah, wa ma malakat aymanukum. You know, make sure you guard your prayer, And make sure you take care of what is in your right hands. Whatever is in your possession. Whoever you are in control of. Whoever is in your responsibility. And number one, all the wives. And the children. And the people who are our subordinates, who we have responsibility over. Oh, this is the status that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving to women. You know, his daughter would come to meet with him, and he sallallahu alaihi wasallam would stand up in her honor. This is the ikram of the women that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave to this ummah. To the daughters of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this hijab is an honor. Because she's so precious. Because she's so beautiful. That Allah Ta'ala wants that it be hidden. كَمْسَالِ لُؤْلُؤِ الْمَكْنُونَ. She's like a hoo. They should be hidden. She's like a hidden pearl. And when these women, they decide to reveal themselves up, they are themselves rejecting that honor that this deen has given them. They decide to leave, to just reject that honor. And also by giving them that hukum of covering themselves up, Allah Ta'ala is actually in reality saying, oh women, you are strong. And oh men, you are weak. So because men, you are weak, and oh women, because you are strong, you cover yourselves up. Because these men, they are weak. And that is the reason when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered to lower the gaze, the first people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked to are the men. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. And then later on, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ. Later on to women. Why? Because women are strong. And that's why you have an honor. You are honorable people. This beauty that's given to you is not that something you reveal to in front of everybody. It's not for everybody. You are very precious. You are not the, you know, somebody who is just walking on the street. You should be kept in a secure place. You are so honorable. You are so beautiful. You are so precious. This is an honor. And when women decide to just, you know, reject their honor that they have been given by Allah, you know, that's, whose fault is that? And that does not mean that people, the men should, you know, look around. Men should lower their gaze. That's their struggle. So this is combination of both, because if any of these things don't happen, the women become a fitna. They become the entrapments of shaitan. Shaitan then uses them to trap men. So this is why Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is mentioned separately, أَوْ إِمْرَأَةٍ يَتَزَوَّجُهَا. If somebody migrates with a different intention, then his intent is, reward is for whatever he is intended for. It may be some reward, it can be no reward. The reward only comes if there is sincerity in the heart. This is about sincerity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is alone. La ilaha illallah. There is nobody worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this tawheed, the true tawheed, also requires that we do everything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. We only have one intention, and that is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. We should not have any other intention mixed up with that, because that's sort of shirk. That's sort of shirk. Because we are associating a partner with Allah. I do it for Allah, but at the very same time, I do it for this as well. This is sort of a shirk. Allah Ta'ala is only being who is worthy of all our, that our action should only be for Him. وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. Allah Ta'ala said, I only commanded that people should worship with pure sincerity in the religion. Allah Ta'ala demands that sincerity. The first three people who will enter into the hellfire according to what hadith would be the people who outwardly were very pious and great people. An alim, a shaheed, a person who is ghani, who gives a lot in charity for. So they will be brought, and Allah Ta'ala will ask them, why did you gain knowledge? Why? He would say, Ya Allah, I gained knowledge because so that I could learn and I could teach for your sake. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, No. That's not the reason why do you gain knowledge. The reason that you gain knowledge so that you could be called an alim. So that people would praise you. And today, you people call you alim, today there is nothing with me for you. And he will ask, he will command the angels to throw him into the fire of hell. And a shaheed would be brought. What did you do? Ya Allah, I fought for your sake, and I gave my life for your sake. Allah Ta'ala would say, no. You fought so that people could call you brave man. And you have got what you were looking for. And people called you brave after your death. And today I have nothing for you. And it will be asked that you throw him into the hellfire. And a person who used to give a lot in charity, a very wealthy man, a very generous man, he would be brought, what did you do, Ya Allah? You gave me so much wealth, I gave it to people, I distributed to people for your sake. Allah Ta'ala will say, no. You gave it to people so that people will call you generous man. People have called you generous man, you got what you intended, I have nothing for you today, into the hellfire. This is how much sincerity counts in our actions. That's why, yeah, ostentation, showing off, doing things for the sake of other people is also shirk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about the munafiqeen, the hypocrites. وَإِذَا قَامُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ قَامُوا كُسَالَى يُرَاءُونَ النَّاسِ. When these people, they stand up for prayer, they are very lazy in their prayers. They do it to show off to people. They do it to show off to people. They are just a sign of hypocrisy. Why? Because there is nifaq in the heart. People say la ilaha illallah and they stand up for prayer outwardly, but their intention is something else. So we need to make sure that we work on our hearts to make correct our intentions. Because innama al-a'malu bin-niyyati, every action that we do, even if it's outwardly for the sake of Allah, if the intention is not right, then there will be no reward for that. And rather, it may become a punishment for those people, if the intention is not right. Our mashayikh have said that this ummah has not been destroyed so much because of bad intentions, and rather they have been left out because of having no intentions. Sometimes people don't have bad intentions. They do things for the sake of Allah. They pray for the sake of Allah, they recite Quran for the sake of Allah, they give in charity for the sake of Allah. But there are many things that we do that we do not have any intention for those. For example, we all get up in the morning. Right? We all get up in the morning and I'm just giving an example. We all take our breakfast. But there is no intention behind a breakfast. We all go out to work. We have no intention to go out for work. We all, for example, put on perfumes before going out. We don't have any intention to put on perfume. What's happening? Huh? We do a lot of things during our day which are from the mustahabbat, which are from the things that are allowed. But we do not have any intentions behind that. So the majority of the things that we do in our daily life, we don't have any intentions. And all of those things can be turned into an act of worship if the intention is there. A right, good intention is there. For example, if I eat my breakfast, I make an intention that I am eating it so that I can enjoy the blessings of Allah and I praise Him for His blessings. I do shukr to Him. There's an intention and you get a reward for that. I can make another intention. I'm eating my breakfast so that I will gain strength out of it and I will be able to go and work and earn for my family because of that. Earning for your family is itself an ibadah. You get a reward for that, just for eating breakfast. You make an intention that I'm eating so that my health remains sound. Taking care of your bodies, this is an amanah that Allah Ta'ala has given us. Taking care of your bodies is also wajib on us. وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, don't put yourself into destruction with your own hands. So I eat so that I can have sound health. You know, making that intention, you will get a reward. We can have multiple intentions of doing the same thing and we will get multiple rewards for that one thing that we normally do every single day and we do it without intention. We go out for work, we make an intention, I'm going out for the sake of Allah so that I can earn halal rizq to feed my family. You will get a reward for that. Going out. We put on our shoes every time. A very, you know, basic act. You put on your right foot first. I'm putting on my right foot first because Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to put his right foot first. You'll get the reward of putting your shoes on. To take off your clothes, you take off from your left side, because this was the sunnah of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You get the reward of taking off your clothes. When you're putting on, you start with your right. You get the reward, because it's the sunnah of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You get the reward of putting on clothes. You enter into the toilet with left foot because the sunnah. You enter to get the reward of entering into the toilet. You take your right foot first out with the intention of following the sunnah. You get the reward of getting out of the toilet. You clean yourselves after leaving yourselves the way the sunnah. You get the reward of cleaning yourself. And I can go on and on. It's 5 minutes. So, this is what our mashayikh have said, that you get the reward of, you can get the reward of everything. And this ummah has lost all of these rewards because of having no intentions. Because many people are aware of the fact that they cannot have bad intentions, but people have lost the reward of the majority of the things that they do during the day because of having no intentions. So this is something that we all need to learn. This is something that we all need to struggle. This is something that we all need to be aware of. That, you know, let's make sure that we check our intentions before doing anything. Sitting, standing, talking, walking, going out, getting into the house, you know, eating, drinking, being with your family, with your wives, with your husband, with your kids, talking to your friends. If we have this istizah, this awareness, that you know, oh, I'm here for the sake of Allah, I'm going back to Allah, I should live my life according to Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. People will get reward, and their book of deeds will be increased every single day with every single moment. And on the day of judgment, you know, when they will see all of these rewards in their book of deeds, they'll be amazed. And that all comes just by having a good intention. I'm not asking to do anything extra. All what I'm asking is to make sure that we, number one, we have intention, and number two, we have the right intentions. So this is something that we all need to work on. Our mashayikh have also said that we should do intentions at least thrice in every act. At the beginning, in the middle, and at the end. Because shaitan, he knows. He's our biggest enemy. He knows that, you know, this ummah will be destroyed, can be destroyed through intentions. And it tries to destroy our intentions. So we should check our intentions in the beginning, we should check our intention in the middle, and we should check our intentions at the end. That if our intention, if number one, there is an intention, and number two, that this intention is only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So inshallah, by doing that, just by having this awareness, our book of deeds will increase, that inshallah, you know, we'll get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by having one intention of that solely for doing things for the sake of Allah, and number two, for following the sunnah of the beloved of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give all of us tawfiq that we be able to purify our intentions, because the reward of the intentions are only with, reward of the actions is only with intentions. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Inshallah. Make dua. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. يا مصرف القلوب صرف قلوبنا على طاعتك. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا من الراشدين. اللهم طهر قلوبنا من النفاق وأعمالنا من الرياء وألسنتنا من الكذب وأعيننا من الخيانة فإنك تعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك يا أرحم الراحمين يا أكرم الأكرمين يا كريم يا غفار يا رحيم يا ودود يا وهاب يا ستار يا ستار يا ستار يا حنان يا منان يا الله يا الله. Please accept this gathering from all of us. يا الله, all of these people who have come, يا الله, please accept their coming. يا الله, all the shortcomings that we had, يا الله, in our ikhlas, in our intentions, يا الله, in our saying things, in our listening to things, the lack of adab, يا الله, please forgive us of our shortcomings. Allah, still we beg you that you please accept this gathering from all of us. يا أرحم الراحمين, يا أكرم الأكرمين, يا الله, these ahadith that we are, يا الله, going over, يا الله, we beg you that you give us the same reward that the Sahaba would have by listening to the beautiful words of your beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. يا الله, the nur that used to get transmitted over from the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam into the hearts of the Sahaba, we beg you, ya Allah, that you transfer the same nur just by reciting these beautiful words of the beloved, of your beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam into our hearts as well. Ya Arham al-Rahimeen, Ya Akram al-Akrameen, Ya Allah, you yourself have said, Ya Ayyuhun Nas, Antum al-Fuqara'u in Allah, that O people, you are beggars in front of Allah. Ya Allah, this group of beggars is here begging you of your mercy. Ya Allah, please grant us the charity of your mercy. Ya Allah, grant us the charity of your love. Ya Allah, the grant us the charity of the love of your beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Allah, all people who have asked for du'as, we beg you, Ya Allah, that you know their needs more than we do, Ya Allah. You grant them more than what they can think of, with khair, with afiyah, Ya Allah, with all goodness, with protection, Ya Rahman Rahmeen. Ya Allah, please accept us for the sake of your deen, for the service of your deen. Ya Allah, please protect this center, Ya Allah. Save us from all fitnas. Ya Allah, save it from all troubles. Ya Allah, make it the source of light. Ya Allah, please accept it for the spreading of your deen, Ya Allah, in all corners of the world, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. Ya Allah, all the people who serve your deen, Ya Allah, who serve the cause of your deen in any shape or form, Ya Allah, we beg you that you grant them your special closeness and your special love and your special attention, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, please allow us that we be able to recite kalima as our last word before we pass. And Ya Allah, please be happy with us, Ya Allah, before we die. Ya Allah, be happy with us at every single moment of our lives. Ya Allah, allow us to live a life of your obedience, of your protection, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. Ya Allah, please make our graves easy for us. Make the questions of the graves easy for us. Ya Allah, save us from the punishments of the dunya, of the grave, of the hereafter. Ya Allah, please give our books in our right hands. Ya Allah, grant us the shade of your throne. Ya Allah, grant us the water from the blessed hands of your beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Allah, grant all of us his intercession, Ya Allah. And let us please enter into paradise without asking, without questioning, without reckoning. Ya Allah, give us a space in the neighborhood of your beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rabbana taqabbal minna. إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم وصلى اللهم تعالى على خير خلقه سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم